The rush hour continues, and right now we are in the Rush Talk segment. Tonight we speak about the COP27, which just ended over the weekend on Saturday in Egypt. The COP27 was meant to end on Friday, but because a few sticking issues remained, it was pushed to Saturday. Now, among the things that COP27 or the SCoRs in 2027 was the creation of the Loss and Damage Fund. Now, the Loss and Damage Fund is meant to help poor countries that are suffering the effects or the impact of climate change to mitigate some of these impacts, for instance, floods here in Kampala. Now, the big guys who are emitting, who are producing a lot of emissions, are supposed to contribute to that fund. And then the amount that they contribute in that fund is meant to help the countries that are emitting less to take care or to deal with the effects of climate change. Now, as usual, we have Gerard Tenua, a senior multimedia journalist here at New Vision, who is also an expert in climate change issues because he has been looking in that direction for a very long time. Gerard is already on set, and we already want to get to him to tell us what are the key takers from the COP27, which ended over the weekend. Gerard.
Good morning, Edward, and good morning, viewers. Of course, COP27 has been going on for the past 2 weeks in Sharm el-Sheikh, Egypt, and this is where the Conference of Parties were engaged in negotiations. And of course, as you know, negotiations about give and take. And of course, one of the things which we took from there as Africa was loss and damage. This is something which was raised in the previous COP, COP26 in Glasgow. And of course, countries in Africa were saying, look, you are talking about two actions about climate change. That is adaptation and mitigation. Mitigation meaning that countries that are producing and are responsible for those huge emissions that are responsible for climate change, you should cut them. That is mitigation. Then there's also adaptation, which is, of course, the climate is changing and we need to become more resilient. We need to get capacity to be able to live in a changing environment. Things like, let me say, switching technology, like if, for instance, power is going to be affected, the hydroelectric power, we shift it to solar, that kind of thing. That is a form of adaptation. But countries in Africa have been saying, look, as you talk about those two actions, we are suffering huge losses back home. A flood has happened, like in Kasese, actually several of them. Mbale is experiencing landslides. Recently, we also had floods in Mbale City for the first time. Kampala is also experiencing floods and loss of lives. So countries are saying that countries, rich countries that are responsible for these huge emissions in the atmosphere should be able to address this damage. And then, of course.
But Gerard, is this the best way to deal with climate change issues? Because the big guys here should be able to meet the cost. But does that mean that then the effects will be less?
Of course, this is responsibility. You've done damage, you've knocked my car on the road. It's not enough to say sorry. You've got to repair my car. That is the thing. Whether you repair your car or not, for me, I don't care. You've knocked my car, I'm not responsible for this accident. You fix it. Developed countries that have been developing since the Industrial Revolution in 1850, and they have emitted all these gases, they must be able to fix what they have caused. And this is what countries are saying. You can imagine Uganda's budget putting a lot of money, by about 60% of its budget, in infrastructure development for the past 5 years, hoping that this is going to be the backbone of our future development. And then after that, we switch into socioeconomic development that can ride on the infrastructure to be able to improve the economy and the socioeconomic well-being. What happens? A flood blows all bridges in Kasese, Bududa, and it takes actually work that has been done in the past 20 years, 30 years, in just a flash. And this is what we are saying. Of course, fixing some of this is not enough. As countries, we must scale up. Look at Kampala. We are damaging all our ecosystems, the forests, the wetlands, and we have pollution down in Lake Victoria. Mm. Will the money for loss and damage address that? No. People have died in Mutungo, three of them. Mm. Will the fund which is going to come from loss and damage, will it address that? No. People have lost lives. Imagine those families, the kind of hopes they tied with these people. The breadwinners are gone. Where are those children? So we need to style up. We need to live in an environment which we care for, mm-hmm. because good ecosystems, health ecosystems, will act as a shield to some of these vagaries of nature.
Okay. Are there any lessons that we pick locally from the COP27?
Yes, plenty of them. Mm-hmm. One of them is that negotiations at that level, it's a give and take. The guys who have the power, they will not just simply allow you to walk into the room and take whatever you want. Mm-hmm. You must have a negotiated path to get to where we are. That is the lesson from loss and damage. Mm-hmm. But of course, the other aspect is that climate change, controlling it will take a bit of time. Countries have invested in fossil fuels, and decoupling this kind of arrangement is going to take a long period of time. There has been a lot of capitalization in things like oil, coal, and etc. So to cause an energy shift where those economies can be able to adopt environmentally friendly technologies, mm-hmm. is going to take quite a while. But of course, the other key issue is that we are also getting awareness at the highest level, because at some point, some people and countries were advancing a notion that this climate change is a hoax. Yet it is not. And of course, countries are sharing what's happening. We've seen the floods in Pakistan. We've seen the floods in Nigeria. We've been there in the Great Lakes region, Lake Victoria, Choga, and mm-hmm. Albert have been flooded for the past 3 years. So that kind of realization, mm-hmm. where we are sharing as countries, as regions, and the global community, mm-hmm. is pushing the point home that we must act. And then, of course, getting actions at that global level is one thing, mm-hmm. but we need actions locally, because that's where the game is going to be won or lost.
Mm-hmm. Now, at COP27, there are some countries that expressed dissatisfaction, like Germany, for instance, that expressed a lot of dissatisfaction for the fact that the production of fossils has not been stopped in the COP27, because it had been hoped that by 2025, the production of fossils will have significantly gone down. Now, other countries like Maldives, they say the continued production or emission of fossils is an existential threat to them, because Maldives is an island and whose sea level is actually down. And they fear that if this continues and we continually have these climate change effects, eventually their country may suffer quite some significant consequences, including actually totally disappearing. What does this now mean to the entire COP27, especially also the next meeting? What does it spell out?
Of course, these kinds of scenarios we are putting on the table, mm-hmm. Are real life experiences. Mm-hmm. There are countries like Maldives, and even in the Pacific Ocean, Tuvalu, that are under threat. The sea levels are rising, and some of these countries are going to go underwater. Can you imagine waking up one day and they tell you there is no Uganda?
No, waking up one morning and what wakes you up is that your entire house is submerged.
Exactly. By that time, probably you will not even be existing. Uh-huh. Yes, mm-hmm. But of course, we have natural reaction to some of these shocks. Mm. People may have actually to leave once their lives and economies come under threat. They have to migrate, and even in Africa, even including Uganda, we have so many refugees coming from other countries. And some of this, the precursor of these movements, mm. is climate change. But going back to the point, is that they are very big threats countries are facing, especially the island states. They are going to disappear in the next probably 20 or 30 years. You may not have a country called Tuvalu. It will be underwater. Can you imagine? Where will they go? Will they have a president? Will they have a cabinet? Who is going to accept them? And then, of course, there's that natural connection. I've been living as a Musoga from Iganga with huge connections, my ancestral home, my social network, How do you tell me that you're going to displace me and take me to somewhere in Tanzania or South Africa?
Or to Seychelles,
yes,
or some,
exactly.
somewhere over there.
Yeah, and that's what
where you have no single connection whatsoever.
Yes, and that's what makes climate change a very urgent issue to address. But of course, the realities of this world also is that climate change is also about power. The guys who are powerful, they don't want to get out of their comfort zones to swallow these bitter pills which other countries are saying you must swallow. Because you find that the guys who are responsible of the emissions are the corporate world. They have made money out of coal, out of oil. But then the guys who are penning their signatures on these documents and who are involved in these negotiations, they are the opinion leaders, the politicians. And of course, if you take drastic steps that cut down these emissions, close fossil fuel, you are going to cause loss of employment, you are going to slow down economic growth, and that would mean you are going to become a very unpopular politician in your country. Mm-hmm. So countries, because of that, they take this kind of a balanced approach. You take some cuts, some decisions, but not wholesale. It's like driving a truck which is so heavy, and it's not going to stop immediately. It needs about a range of 100 meters to effectively stop. And this is what is happening with the fossil fuel. And the countries are saying they have invested a lot of money in this sector, so they need to recoup some of that money as they transit to other friendly forms of energy. Take, for instance, Total Energies. They are talking about Total Energies by 2050. That's when probably they will be selling the last drop of oil and they'll shift.
And our where very own here where we are just beginning to produce oil.
Exactly. Mm. We've been investing in this exploration, this ridge what, to build these roads, do EIS. How
E-Corp.
Do you? Yes. Mm-hmm. E-Corp. Now, how do you tell us that oil should stay in the ground? Of course, we are saying that, look here, we can look at environmentally friendly ways of getting that oil out of the ground. There are concepts like zero emissions. We can be able to quantify how much emissions this oil is going to produce once it comes out of the ground. And then we say, let us plant trees, for instance, an equivalent that can absorb those waste gases. Mm. We also have so many forests that have been degraded over time. Mm. And of course, restoration, growing them back into what they used to be, they are going to grow gradually into bigger trees and then, of course, tall trees. Mm. And this will absorb a lot of this energy. Mm. Why don't we get support from the international community so that we be able to extract this oil? We develop our economy, even cause an energy shift. Instead of people depending on biomass, they develop and probably they are using solar, they can afford electricity, and then we'll even talk about a more sustainable way of using the environment.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely. That obviously shifts the burden or reduces the burden. But again, I'm wondering what or whether the geopolitics in Europe, the Russia-Ukraine war, has anything to do with the decisions that were made in Egypt at COP27, especially on emission of from fossils?
Of course, these have direct ramifications on what is happening. You look at pandemics like COVID, now the war in Ukraine, and of course Russia. This has implications on how business is going to be done, how we are going to discuss this. It's one thing, I cannot go to stop a fire from my neighbor's house when my house is on fire. How am I going to get cheap energy for myself to cushion my economy and my people so that I'm able to come back for the next term? Rather than go to say, okay, I'm going to get costly energy, and then of course you guys, you might lose half of your what you've made out of your economy, and about half of you are going to become jobless. That is so unpopular, and these are realities that are happening with these rich countries. And that is why probably they may not say it openly. They say, wait a minute, there's another COP, and of course you can keep on negotiating this and that, but those are realities. You cannot stop a fire on your neighbor's house when your own
when
house
your
is
own
on fire.
Is on fire. So we are likely to see the status quo remain for as long as everything remains the way it is.
Of course, we need to keep on negotiating, getting space to assert ourselves and do what is possible. Mm. And of course, in Africa, we know we never chase the devil. We keep on negotiating with it. When there's a bad spirit, they'll say, what does it want? It wants chicken or a goat, you give it. So you keep on moving. And that is what is going to happen with that bad spirit of climate change.
Okay.
We'll keep on negotiating.
Appeasing it.
Yes, of course, and negotiating for space.
Okay.
That is the reality. You cannot just simply keep outside the fence and say, it's either this or never. We need to keep on negotiating for space.
But then there is the fundamental question of keeping global temperatures at 1.5 degrees Celsius. With all of this, how do we achieve that?
Oh, of course, there's the Paris Agreement, and it is meant to exactly address that. Mm. By 2015, countries realized that the warming was going to shoot above 2 degrees centigrade, beyond which temperatures are going to increase in a spiral, and you'll not talk of just a few calamities like Bududa or Kasese or floods in Kampala. We are going to have a great deal of some of these disasters once the temperatures rise. Now, in 2015, countries appended their signatures to yet another agreement, the 2015 Paris Agreement on Climate Change, we have restrictions of certain actions so that we keep the temperatures not above 1.5 degrees Celsius. And among those actions which countries are taking is a policy or a plan which is called the National Determining Contribution. This is a raft of activities which countries have put in place to be able to cut down emissions. Just like I pointed out earlier, that if you've knocked my car, you've got to fix it. But under the Paris Agreement of 2015, even countries that are not responsible for these emissions that are warming up the world, including Uganda, they're accepting responsibility. That, look, we did not cause the problem, but we are going to cut down our emissions, even if they are so small, we are going to cut down 24.7% of our emissions. And you can imagine, if you have 100 Ugandans, and you add them together, Tanzania, Kenya, etc., you will have kind of a significant step you are doing to cut down those emissions. And of course, these developed countries have used those bad development processes to be able to develop. But of course, we need to work with them to not to walk the same path, so that we have green economies, we promote green growth, we do things like energy is wealth, waste is wealth. That waste which we get from our homes, the organic waste, it also causes emissions. Mm-hmm. But if we convert them into usable materials like manure, mm-hmm. we cut down on those emissions. And if we have manure and put it in our garden, okay. we even make our farmers more resilient to the extent that if there is climate change, the manure will help these plants to grow, and then the plants will also retain a lot of water. Mm-hmm. So such action is what we've got to take, because we are also taking responsibility to be able to cut down emissions.
Let us look at this loss and damage fund. It is a good thing. The other time we were talking about it and said it's a good thing actually to have in place. Now we have it in place. But now the question is on enforceability of the fund. Making sure that now the rich guys actually put money in the fund, and that the guys who need actually to use the fund receive the money and actually use it for the intended purpose. How can this be enforced, and how sustainable can it get? How can we ensure those two?
Of course, we talked about the key outcome of COP27 in its broad sense, but of course they agreed, that was one of the agreements, but capitalization and implementation of that fund may take a while. Mm. I'll give you an example. We have what we call the Green Climate Fund, which is supposed to support adaptation activities, which was set up in 2009. Mm. Up to now, fund has not been capitalized up to 30%. Mm. Between 2009 and today, that is about 13 years. So you can imagine, even loss and damage, yes, they agreed to create it, but of course, its actualization is also going to take some time, with those factors in the background which we've mentioned, the war which is between Russia and Ukraine, the COVID pandemics, and all of that. And mind you, the guys who have the power and they have caused this damage to the atmosphere, they are not so willing, they are not so forthcoming to say, here is the money which you need for this fund. So that one, I think, will also keep on pushing these guys to be able to capitalize the same way how the Global Climate Fund has come up, and of course they are slowly putting their money, and maybe one day there will be adequate funding for the rest of us to access. But of course, coming back home, I want to put this very clear. Prevention is better than cure. Why do we wait for these funds and to access money to be able to fix things in Kampala City? Mm. We don't have a drainage plan for Kampala, or there's none that has been implemented. The Kampala development plan, our physical development plan, has never been implemented for the last 40, 50 years. Mm-hmm. What are we waiting for? What, I mean, if we do all this damage, what sort of damage are we going to cause to ourselves, our ecosystem, our lake, so many things? And how much money would you need to fix that?
Well, Gerard, those are interesting questions that we actually need to put in perspective and that we need to get answers to. Unfortunately, because of time, we will have to end it at this. We take a short break, but when we return, we shall have the big issue continuing from there.
Weddings will never go out of style, but trends definitely.